may be watching this meeting live or the recording that is made and then available by Knowsley Council's website. In light of this, can I remind all members of their data protection responsibilities and ask that you ensure that during the meeting you do not share any personal or private information that may have been shared with you by constituents. So no naming of anybody, please. And can I just offer some apologies? I'm not quite well. No pause. And I may just have to stop for a moment sometimes to think straight. You know, it's just the way of life, isn't it? Louise? Right, we've got quite a few people in the room this morning on this one. I think it'd be really useful to do welcome and introductions. So I'm going to start here first with the panel, and then we'll move to your side, Commissioner. Okay? I'm Councillor Barbara Murray. I represent New Tree Ward in Liverpool.
I'm Councillor Peter Harvey. I'm one of the safety representatives. Oh, apologies.
Can we remind everyone to use the mics, please? Pat?
Morning, Councillor Pat Maloney, Chilwell Ward in Liverpool.
Councillor Joanne Kennedy, Sandfield Park Ward in Liverpool.
Great to have you as independent vice chair. Councillor Tony Murphy, Edward Council for Rock Ferry, Liverpool Council.
Keith Dickinson, Direction Resources.
Good morning, Chris Green, Deputy Chief Constable.
Good morning, Rhys Reid, Chief Constable.
Emily Smurl, Chief Crime Commissioner.
Right. John Marley, Chief Manager of the Police Crime Commissioner.
Good morning, everybody. James Leeson, Head of Business Services and Assurance for Police and Crime Commissioner.
Good morning, everyone. Sue McTaggart, Chief Executive, Police and Crime Commissioner.
Good morning, Jeannie Bell, Deputy Police and Crime Commissioner.
Thanks, everyone. Can I just ask Lindsay if you have any apologies, please?
Thanks, Chair. Apologies received from Councillor Dickinson, Councillor Coleman, Councillor Boone, and Councillor Powell.
Our first item is the minutes of the previous meeting, which are mainly for noting. I think there were some typos which have been sorted, but are there any matters arising? Or any objections? Yeah, of accuracy. No? Thank you. Lindsay, do we have any declarations of interest?
No, I'm just going to check.
Thank you. Our next item today, which is a major item for this panel, is the PCC's preset proposal for 24-25. Commissioner, can you take us through your report, please? Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Chair. So this is obviously a report for the proposal for the preset. This is one of the duties that I have as a police crime commissioner to make a proposal around this, and you obviously have the option to consider it as a panel. Hopefully, lots of you attended the briefing that John did on Friday, so went through a lot of detail. So I can appreciate there's quite a lot of detail in terms of the wider budget and the impact of the various funding streams. So hopefully that was useful. Broadly speaking, we were given the flexibility or the ability to increase the precept to £13 for a Band D property, which I think is about 17p a week for a Band D in terms of what it increases to, and that's about just over 5%. Increase, so comparable with council increases and other preset flexibilities as well. I will say, I suppose I mentioned some of the challenges, it's not enough. So even if we do this, we are still going to face some quite severe challenges in terms of trying to meet the budget, and the chief will talk about some of the challenges that she's got around operational and savings and things like that. This is something we've called upon a number of times, I know I've raised it here before as a panel around this feedback, to the that we don't think this is a fair way to fund public services like the police. I recognise that there were huge pressures on our communities at the minute and the cost of living crisis, and that came through the public survey that we did, and we did consult with the public, and we
overall strategy is remaining the same in terms of putting the communities first in everything we do. It's very much at the heart of every decision we make, and I think it's very evident in our investment that we've made over the past 3 years in terms of we have absolutely put our investment into frontline services. So those investments have gone into response patrol, local policing, investigation, a real focus on increasing our visibility in our communities, but also that proactive approach and that visibility. I think our focus on frontline services and putting communities at the heart of everything we do is evident in the HMRC FRS value for money framework. We have the second highest spend in the country per population on frontline services, and we have the third lowest spend on our back office functions around business services. That's because over recent years we really look to where we can make savings, try to ensure we don't take away from frontline services, which I know are incredibly important to our communities. So there's a real strong focus in force on delivering communities, providing that excellent service. Just some of the reductions that we've seen just this year alone, we reduced all crime by 17,000. We reduced burglaries by 18%. That means 568 homeowners, and we just talk about residential burglaries, have not been subjected to a burglary. We reduced murder by 72%. Now, I would say that anybody losing their life to that most horrific crime is one too many, but there's 16 less people this year on Merseyside to have families going through that grief. And we've reduced violence by 6,500 crimes this year. In relation to the budget, and you can see that set out for 24-25 is an estimated nearly £9 million deficit. But please be reassured that we haven't been waiting for the taxpayers to try and the taxpayers' money to make the savings. We've been really proactive over recent years. We've made £17 million worth of savings since 2018-2019. And we've built up reserves through really strong financial management, I think, which we are able to use, as you will see, set out in the budget. If you also think about the budget report that was presented in October 2023 to the panel, that savings channel for the force for 24-25 was £0.6 million. But we now, through the work that we are doing, have identified for next year £2.8 million worth of savings, but we still next year, even if this budget is approved, we need to make a further £1 million worth of savings. You'll note that the increase in the midterm financial strategy, and John will have briefed you on it, goes from £15 million to £20.7 million, and that has been explained in the report, but I just want to reassure you that that is not due to poor financial management, it's due to the way in which we are being funded, and it will take transformational funding to achieve that level of savings. Places where we would normally seek to go to find those savings are things like the non-pay budget, but this year the non-pay budget in terms of it's actually increased because of inflationary costs etc. by 16%, so we can't go to that area where we would call it a soft target. It's not a soft target, but the areas where we would normally go because of the cost of living crisis and because of fuel increases, we are having to manage that 16% increase. Again, it's outlined in the report around that split between police officer and police staff. And it's really positive that we've been able to increase the number of officers working within Merseyside Police by 650 due to the Operation Uplift 665, going due to Operation Uplift. And we've also managed to increase our police staff workforce by 350. And so we are almost back to our 2010-2011 numbers with police staff. However, we are still 450 short of our 2010-2011 numbers for police officers. But those skills of our police staff colleagues are absolutely a vital part of the police and family. As local councillors, you will very much appreciate that with our PCSO numbers. But the investment that we have made in our police staff numbers have allowed us to recruit, train and retrain our staff whilst also making sure that we can maintain our front line numbers. Obviously set out within the midterm financial strategy is our capital plan, which includes spend on our estate, our IT and our kit. We absolutely need a modern estate, fleet and IT that is efficient and fit for policing the needs of our
sustainability. We are nationally recognised for the approach that we are taking to sustainability, and I think it's becoming increasingly more important to our community, but also to our workforce. And again, I'm aware that you've been making the presentation on the state strategy, our huge commitment in relation to ensuring that we have local employability and use of local suppliers. Set out in the budget is those proposed assumptions, and it talks to the pay rise. It talks to the proposed pay rise. That was very positive for policing this year, that we got a 7% pay rise. As the Federation have identified, policing has actually suffered a 17% pay cut in real terms since 2020 to 2010, like for all public sectors. For each percent of pay rise, we know that the impact that that has on our budget, which is why we've seen part of the increase from the £15 million savings deficit to the £20 million. So only everything over 2.5% was funded this year. Now, I really hope that my workforce, those pay rises increase because of the financial challenges that I've already spoken to. But with each, I say, between 0% and 2.5%, we know the impact that has on our budget. Merseyside is a fantastic region, and because of that we attract lots of events, and we are really proud to work with our partners to ensure the safety of our local communities, our national visitors and also our international visitors. But actually what that means for us is that we are using resources locally to make sure that we can deliver those responses. And whilst we can recover a lot of the costs, there are some costs that we can't recover. We need to make sure that in light of those events, but also the significant events that we've known taking place in recent years, those five firearms murders last year, which have seen fantastic sentences secured for the murders of Ashley Dale, Olivia Crackwell and Ellie Edwards, and then the building work that we've done on Clearhorn Field. But I think in terms of the need for Merseyside to be able to have that strong focus on local policing, that proactivity and that visibility in our communities. We have, in the past 12 months, done two public perception surveys, and the feedback from our communities is that 80% support Merseyside Police, 65% feel that Merseyside Police can be relied upon to be when needed, and 65% are confident that they will receive a good service, and that 68% felt that Merseyside Police were responding effectively to emergencies. So some very positive results there compared to the national picture. But from my perspective as Chief Constable, when we're seeing that legacy FRS. The other thing I will point out is that we haven't had to cut from the front line, so we have increased our number of officers and we have used the precept increases wisely that we saw probably between 2018 and 2020, and then the additional funding coming in through Operation Uplift to make sure that we can continue to invest in the front line, particularly in neighbourhood policing and response and control and investigations, but also increasing our police staff family. But I envisage, and John and Keith probably answer the financial, their view in terms of the OBR, that I think over the next 5 years, which is a length of time of the midterm financial strategy, we will continue to make those financial savings.
How do you appreciate the midterm financial strategy? The assumptions are very crude around that with regards to inflation, pay awards, and the precept itself. The real problem is funding of precepts in real terms is insufficient going forward, even to address pay crisis. And that's why we won't ever get to a neutral position until that is resolved nationally, I think. Towards the end of the NHFS, there are some additional costs around the implementation of the state strategy that would have an impact. But I mean, those are needed to help and grow and make efficiency that down the line. So I think a cost neutral position, unless there's real terms funding increase down the line, it won't happen under the current assumptions. But I would say those assumptions are very improved. Inflation pay awards, 2 times pay award, well, yeah, that's the situation at the moment.
I hope this is right as well, obviously. We've talked about the fact that there needs to be a fundamental shift in how policing is funded in terms of being able to balance that, and that must be something that's your company decision. So obviously mindful of the fact that we are anticipating the general election coming in, whatever that government looks like, we will certainly be continuing to have those conversations and make that plea that actually the current approach to police funding is not sustainable and doesn't work in terms of being able to just push the burden constantly out to council taxpayers is not the right way to do it. So I think just to reassure you, we are raising some concerns naturally as well, because this is something that we affect in policing as a whole.
Right. It's important that simply the size of the cake increases, not just the way it's cut. The one more way we change the way the cake is cut, but the cake needs to be integrated in some technical.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. I think we agree about the lack of sustainability of the funding for the police, and I would agree wholeheartedly with your comment about council tax being a very aggressive form of taxation. And I'm just wondering whether you're getting any feeling of recognition of that from the Home Office, if not at the political level, at the operational level, and in terms of really the Treasury, whether there are any views there on making not just police funding sustainable, but also local government funding in general more sustainable and also fairer, which it has become more and more unfair, especially at the time when we see, and obviously the police are suffering the crisis in inflation and cutting standard of living, which has been ongoing for the last 40 years, and it's something that at some stage needs to be resolved. Thank you, Chair.
Yes, it's a really good question. So John alluded to the funding formula, which is how they decide how much each police force area gets as part of that cake funding as to what it is, what's the piece that cake gets. They have been doing a review of that for many, many months and probably years now, and they've yet to bring it forward. So there are a number of us who are kind of saying, we believe that we should do a fairer portion of that, looking at the demand and the challenges that we have here, poverty and all those kind of things. But they don't seem to make any kind of commitments to actually deliver on that. So I think that's something, they're saying the right things, but they're not actually moving anything forward. So I think that's part of that challenge. To give you some indication about where they sit with it. And as John says, all that's going to do is probably change the slice that you get rather than the actual pot. So we'll always say still fighting over the same amount of money. I think in terms of the attitude that we have, you can, my take on it is, when you but it will all be, it is coming from funding from the Home Office.
Thanks, Chair. Commissioner, I was just going to, it was reassuring to hear you say that pushing the burden onto council taxpayers is not the way to do it. I think we probably all agree on that. But that's the situation you've been put into. Can I ask about the survey that you did, or the survey that you commissioned, the summary of the findings? So this was a public survey. You talked to about 1,000 respondents. Around a quarter of the respondents, 27%, said they are willing to contribute the additional 17 pence for a Band A property. And I think it's equates to, is it 25 pence for a Band D property? 17 pence for the lowest is for Band A, but 25 pence for Band D.
Yes.
So you've gone to the public, you've asked them, you know, would you be happy or are you willing to pay the extra? The answer's come back that 27% are not willing. We've still got to ask them to pay anyway. Now, how would you, can I ask them, how would you justify that to the respondents and to the Merseyside community at large?
Well, I think in terms of making this decision, part of the decision process that I have to go through is to ask the public, as you say, as well as coming here and speaking to yourselves, obviously speaking to the chief about what her view would be about budget pressures. So, you know, I think we've reflected quite hard on the fact that there has been such a drop, and I think we recognise that those pressures are very, very real. And I think that would be the same if you were to, you know, obviously if the councils were asking a question and who are looking to increase by some amount, and say the fire authority and other, you know, precepting bodies, I think we're all in a very difficult position where we all acknowledge there are huge pressures on the cost of living crisis, but if we don't ask for this extra money, that then the impact of the service delivery is going to be significant. So it is a very difficult one, and we have really tried to respond to that. I think when you look at some of the comments that come through, you know, as I say, there is that pressure and because of cost of living, but a lot of people are saying it's because the government should be paying for it, or they just don't feel that it's the right way to fund it. And so I think those are messages that we will absolutely feed back. So when we get pushback from government to say you should be going out to ask your council taxpayers, our pushback will be, but actually they're telling us that this is going to be a challenge for them. And so we are using all this information to try and write back to Home Office and say this is not how we want to do it. But the reality is, if I don't ask, then we end up with, as I say, more savings and more challenges for the chief in terms of delivering the right service for people this side.
Yeah, and I think we do have, you know, sympathy with you, and it's good that you refer to the comments from the survey. Some people have said the government should give a bigger budget. They shouldn't be asking us, we're already struggling. The government should fund it as we pay enough taxes. The government should increase the budget. So I think there is some clarity from the public generally,
yeah,
that it's not their responsibility to narrow it or to fill that gap in terms of funding. It is down to the government, and that's good to hear. You refer to a drop, and presumably this is, you know, an annual survey that you do, or a very similar survey, yeah, each year. Are you in a position to give us comparative figures to the 27%? How does that compare to public support in previous years?
So from memory, I think we had about 50% last year who were in favour. And I think it was about 30% who we don't know, and the remainder, sorry, 50% who know, and the remainder who don't know. So I think we hit about 50% last year who were supportive. So obviously you can see that there has been a drop in that this year, which in, yeah, in some ways is expected.
Right. But again, it might reflect the frustration of the public that they feel you shouldn't be asking, you shouldn't have to ask. Just one more question on the survey. I'm not sure which page it was, but there was a breakdown of the respondents, where they're from. And it seemed to be a little bit top-heavy in terms of the local, who are the various authorities. So obviously we've got the fire authorities, Knowsley, Liverpool, Septon, St Helens and Wirral. And the percentage of the sample from Liverpool was 47%. Liverpool is the largest constituent out of those five, but it's not as high as 47%. Is there any reason for that?
So the brief that we give the company to do is that it needs to be statistically significant. So what they do when doing surveys, make sure it is reflective of the demographics and the population centres around Merseyside. So as far as we're concerned, that's reflective of that.
shortage of loss of paid police staff over the years. They may be seeking to increase that over and above the 2.5% that we're budgeting for, so I think that's a significant risk. Chief Constable also mentioned about low numbers of back office staff, and I just wondered if you might comment on the, I think it's called de-civilianisation, essentially that we have well-paid and trained police officers who end up doing administrative work which would have been done by admin staff.
to the increase in the precept, and it might be something John might be able to help with. Since 2017 and 18, the band D charge, or going back to 2017-18, the band D charge was £165. The proposed charge